Welcome. We are continuing with this topic where we are looking at the enemies that stayed in the land when Israel occupied the inheritance. And we have been saying that the same forces, the same demonic forces that were operating behind those enemies are still operating right now. So if we look at the characteristics, and the way we look at it is looking at what was the enemy? Who did God use to defeat the enemy? Why did they come in the first place? And also, like when you look at the kings, what were the kings that were ruling, and what is the translation of their names? And so we see here, we are looking at the Midianite enemy. And the Midianite enemy comes into your camp if you choose comfort over calling. And we said that some of the comfort is not necessarily sin, because we find so many intercessors, they want to stay in the place of prayer. But when God tells them now, it is time to get up and go and execute and go and do whatever it is that they actually had during prayer, they have that trouble or problem of coming from that place of secret place to the place of being builders. And so we find that, and we see that with Joshua, because there was that time that he was always staying next to the ark, staying in the presence. But the time would come when Moses would send him to actually go fight, and also when he became the king. It's not that he left the secret place, but he had to, the secret place is the place for getting instructions. But when you get instructions, you need to go and build. Other people, it's just moving to the level of what it is that you can do, but not in the fullness of it. And so you just do the bare minimum. And if that is the case, then you're choosing comfort over calling. So any place where you're putting comfort ahead of calling, you invite. Remember how the enemy comes. He comes to eat your harvest. And because of the two kings that were defeated, Oreb and Zeb, raven and wolf, they eat anything. Just think of a wolf, just think of a raven. A raven eats anything. So that means that you can't pinpoint what kind of a harvest the enemy is coming for if you choose comfort over calling. So most of the time, this one affects so many Christians, because they are not pushing themselves to the limit. They are only doing maybe one thing and not the other one. Let's say God has told you maybe you need to start a church, you need to record this, you need to do this, so you can juggle maybe, because God is looking at your potential. You have 5 talents and you're using 3. If you're using 3, however good you're using the 3 and you're not using the 2, that means you're still choosing comfort over calling. And so in that case, you open the door for this seasonal devouring. Remember, these are the only enemies of the Jews that did not wish to occupy their land, occupy them. They came at the harvest, ate the harvest, and left. And so if you see that seasonal things happening, like you stay healthy, then you get sick. It devours all your savings. You save again, then you want to do something major, then it's all gone. Then you need to go and break there. Remember what I said. When you see the enemy, remember Jesus has defeated the enemy. So what do? You ask, what kind of enemy is this? Who gave the legal light? So we are going to look at several other ways, just breaking it down to tell you how the enemy might have come into your camp. So the other part is when somebody feels legitimate, when somebody is dependent on them. So it's like, you know, like right now we understand about the, like now with apostolic covering, and then we have, so if somebody is feeling legitimate by being a covering for other people, because your legitimacy, your worth, your capability is supposed to come from God apart from your assignment. And so if your assignment is defining you, that means that you're going to open the door for this enemy. So there's other comfort. The way the Midianites came into the camp, Midian was a son of Abraham. Because Abraham, remember, Abraham had the two sons. He had Ishmael, and then he had Isaac. And then when Sarah died, he married Keturah. And with Keturah, he had six more children. And one of them is the Midianite. And we see he knew he was not supposed to have these children. Because when he had these children, what happened is when it was almost time to die, he sent them away. Where would he send them away? Instead of gathering and accruing generational blessings for Isaac, he started choosing comfort. And so this is how the door was opened for this particular enemy. And so if you choose any kind of body comfort, if you choose any kind of soul comfort or any other kind of comfort, including things that are not necessarily bad, that's what I'm telling you. If you choose the comfort of continually to stay in the place of prayer when God is telling you to go and build the business, and you are afraid of going to go. Remember, you are, even when building the business, you still need to stay in prayer. But if you are refusing to build the business because you want to stay in the prayer, you will open the door for the Midianite enemy. And so that's what we are saying. What you're doing might not necessarily be bad, but it's at the comfort zone. It's the bare minimum. What can you do? You are not pushing yourself to the potential of God that he has put inside of you. So start evaluating your life and say, is there anything else that I'm supposed to do, or is this it? And so that where if you refuse to do what God has called you to do, we see this, the opening of this actually with the Israelites. If you look at the Israelites, if you go back and read the Bible, the day that they came out of Egypt, and on the eighth of Av, and Av is a month, around July and August, God told them to go and occupy the land, and they were very close. But when God told them to go fight, they refused. They chose comfort. And so when they chose comfort, instead of the calling of going to do what God had told them to do, they were supposed to go on the 9th of Av. So that particular day, they chose comfort. And so they opened the door for a devouring. And so if you look at the major tragedies that has happened to the Jewish people, it happens on the 9th of Av. The two temples were destroyed on the same day. And there's 12 other major tragedies that happen on the same day. Because on that particular day, they opened the door for this seasonal devouring. And so sometimes the seasonal devouring, you have to be very careful. It might be every month. Like what I was telling you, some people, it's every October. Some others, every January. I know one lady told me, I get accidents every January, every year. And immediately I told her, that's the Midianite enemy, because it is seasonal. It's coming. Another one, it actually was asking a question, why does my business do well in odd years and not well in even years? That's seasonal devouring. And so you and look at health, look at social relationship. So I usually say this one, if you are not the person who keeps track, you just break down some of the areas, like your relationships, like your relationships at church, your relationships at work, your relationships at home. And so you break them down. Then you look at your growth, your spiritual growth. Do you consistently grow, or do you grow? And then something happens that takes you out of the place of believing, and then now you have to rebuild faith. Again, and then something happens, then that would be a seasonal devouring on your spiritual growth. Look at your mental growth. Look at your face, like your body, the sickness, the disease. Look at your finances. Is there a devouring of your finances? When you keep saving for this project or to expand, then something happens and it does not happen, and it is seasonal. And so that would be a sign that this enemy has come in. And now I'm telling you, what are some of the things things you or your bloodline, your forefathers could have done to open the door. So we said the first one, the easier one, they put comfort ahead of calling. They were supposed to go to work, they went to sleep. They were supposed to pray, they started watching TV. And so there's that where they became couch potatoes. And so that would open the door for that. Then the other one is you refuse to put yourself in a risky position to pursue your birthright. So that would be another one that would open the door. The other one would be putting comfort ahead of holiness. So that is what some people do, like the comfort of sin, like what or moral impurity. So anything that is inappropriate, whether it's something that you are doing, something that you are watching, adultery, things like that, those would be signs that would open the door because you're choosing something comfortable instead of choosing holiness. And then the other one is where you distrust God's power and ability and capability, because when you do that, you still choose comfort. So I'm not going to pray, because the last time I prayed, somebody got sick. You are choosing comfort instead of choosing to believe. For a moment or a season of comfort, someone damaged or limited or hampered, affected or defiled their work and their pursuit of calling. So it's not necessarily continuous. It's for a moment. And so if someone in your family, either they damaged or they limited or they affected their work or their pursuit or calling. So that would mean that maybe you've been called to be a pastor, and for a season of time, you will stop that. You say, I'm not going to do this. And so if you cut that off for a moment, not for any particular reason, like what you're saying, maybe you don't believe in God's capability, you are offended, something happens, that could also open the door. So what do you do when you realize this enemy is there? So when you break the enemy, this one is where God, things that God will give you, or just a way to maintain. Remember, you can only be, I want to make this clear. Most of the time people want prayer, you want impartation, you want people to pray for you. And so you can only be delivered. Just think of your deliverance like, I don't know, like a number line or positive, some it's positive and negative. So when the Midianite enemy is there, depending on how many things they are devouring, we can say, let's say they are negative 20, negative 40. So then when you come and repent, that means that you move that from negative of whatever that was, the devouring of yours, of whatever they were eating, let's say it's your health, let's say your finances, you move it to zero. When you move it to zero, it doesn't automatically move to the positive. So you have to remember, you can only do deliverance up to zero. Whatever thing, you can only come to zero. So to move to the positive of that, to where you start seeing the blessing operating now, like what we are saying with the Israelites, the Midianite enemy, remember, it affects the harvest. So that means it is at the peak when you are supposed to have the most resources coming. That is the time they were supposed to get their inheritance. So if you break the enemy, the same month, like what you are saying, the same month of January, the same month of October, that same day that you are having those recurring defilements, recurring devouring, that same month or that same period is the time that you are supposed to get your, not just your normal resources, not just your normal harvest, it's the time that you are supposed to get the most harvest. So to move in that positive direction, that means that once you break it, you need to do lifestyle changes. So one of the ways that you would change your lifestyle is you start valuing the resources that God has given you, of who you are in Him. Like I have said this, but I'm still going back to it, that God has given you not your pastor, not, I know there's pastors who are listening, but we have to settle that the potential to be able to do what it is God has sent us on the earth to do is within. He has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. And he's a good God. He's a good boss. He's not giving us work and he doesn't give us the resources. And so that would be a way to move to the positive aspect of that. Because if you don't take time to get to know your resources, then what resources are you developing? Then the other one is identify your innate strength. So this would be another way to move on the positive. And you choose to develop them and hone them and honor them. So that time you are sitting there watching TV, so many hours, binge watching Netflix or Hulu or whatever it is that you are binge watching. That time you are devouring, you are inviting the devouring of this particular enemy. And so in that time would be the time that you hone your skills. That would be the time that you work on what God, develop what God has given you. Take time to understand what it is that he has given you. So then the other one is you set aside some comfort in your life. So you have to choose, because you, for you to actually, at the end, you know, I keep reminding us that there's two judgment seats. There's the great white throne judgment in the book of Revelation, where you'll be judged for what you do on the earth. But there's also, you'll be judged for whether you're going to go spend time with God or not spend time with God. So that one, most of the people will be, if you believe in Jesus and you've accepted him in your life, in your life, that means that now with the great throne, white throne judgment, you are already, you know the outcome. But there's the other judgment seat of Christ. On the judgment seat of Christ is where you are judged for what you are doing on the earth with the resources that God gave to you. And so that's what you are saying. If you choose comfort over calling, then when you come to the judgment seat of Christ, remember everything you do will be tested by fire. And so even if the things you do won't pass through the fire, maybe you helped somebody, but you did it out of strife, so it won't count towards the rewards that Jesus is going to give you. That does not mean that you're going to go to hell. It just means that you won't have your crowns. You won't have the works that you did when Jesus gave you everything that pertains to life and godliness. They won't count. And so that's what we are saying. So you set aside time and money to drill down those resources so that you can be able to do it, do the things that God has called you to do. And then you invest time. So I'm looking at what are some of the ways you can overcome the Midianite enemy and move in the positive aspect of it, where you are getting the blessing now and the enemy, you broke the enemy, you repaired your walls, but now you want the blessing. You just don't want to stay there at zero. So you're supposed to invest time and money and effort in moving towards what you already know. Most people are waiting to say, oh God, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. So ask yourself, what is it that you can do right now? If you look at the resources you have, maybe you can encourage someone. God has told you that you're going to feed the world. Don't wait to feed the world, because you have to. It's a precept. It's seed time and harvest. And then there's an increase of the precept. God is looking at your faithfulness. So can you start feeding two people now? Can you just look for two people that are hungry? If you live here, just drive by the bridges and decide I'll be feeding these two people. I was told I'm going to feed the world, but where do I start? Some of the people, like now, we were talking about somebody. Maybe you are told by God you're going to be a minister, or you're going to be a pastor, or you're going, that's the prophetic word, or you are a prophet. And then don't wait until you are saying, okay, now God, I don't have the mic, I can't prophesy, I need the mic. No, you just start, where are you right now? Who can you call your friends? Can you call your family and say, I'm practicing prophecy? Can you read some books on prophecy instead of watching TV? So develop, hone that resources. Think of a violin prayer, and even if God has given them the capability to play the violin inside of their soul, spirit, for them to actually pray, they have to practice and practice and practice until they become better at it. It's only us as Christians, we don't hone the skills. So that's what I'm saying, hone the skills. And then invest in the tools that will contribute to your calling at the expense of your personal comfort. So you might have to forego going out to eat, to save money, to go for those guitar lessons, to go for those violin lessons, to go for that class, to buy that book, to do that. So whatever it is that you need to readjust, that will mean that you are choosing calling instead of comfort. And then you choose the righteous path regarding your life and calling. So that one is clear. You can't be walking in unrighteousness towards your calling. And so if you see any unrighteousness along your path, then you need to walk in a different direction. So what do you receive once you break this enemy? So once you break the enemy, you receive the blessings. One of them is growth in your relationship with God. Because as you keep pursuing what resources He has given you and growing them, you're coming into that place of intimacy with Jesus. Remember, all this, you're not doing it by your own strength. I have to put that into perspective. You're getting your strength from Jesus, your capability from Jesus, your wisdom from Jesus. So you're getting it from Him. And so as you are, remember, you're co-laboring with Him. You're not doing this thing out of your soul and out of yourself. Then the other one is a fulfillment of relationships or things not breaking at certain times. That's what we are calling about seasonal devouring. If it is a car, breaks down every June. Every June, your car breaks down. Every June, your car breaks down. Or every time you get the major client, then that things break down. Or you go to work. And just if you see these things that are keeping on breaking. So if you break the enemy, that means that things are not going to start breaking when the harvest is there, when just at certain times or seasonally. And then because you have more to give, because now most of the people don't understand it is sowing and reaping. We see that if you sow very little and expect very much, then that one is opening the door for the Canaanite enemy. So you need to be able to have. But if every harvest that you need is being devoured, that means you have nothing to sow. That means that you have nothing to reap. Remember, you sow your time, talent, and treasure. So if you can't sow time, if your time is being devoured, you can't sow your treasure if you are using all the money for the hospital bills. And so if you don't sow, you don't reap. And so there's that cycle of not being able to move ahead. And so then this devourment of time is not there, because time is devoured when this keeps happening. Like if things keep breaking down, like now you look at the Israelites, that time of Gideon, they have taken a whole season to harvest crops. Some crops take 8 months, some 6 months. And then the Midianites come at the end and take all the harvest. So that time has been devoured. The time has been eaten up by the enemy. And so if you break the enemy, your time is not going to be devoured anymore. And so that means that you will have time to rest. Remember now, just look at the Israelites during the days of Gideon. The time that they were supposed to be resting, preparing their farm for the next planting, that is the time that they had to form their army and go fight and then come and plant again. And if the enemy keeps coming, that means that you will never rest. And if you don't find that seat of rest, there is no way that you can be able to advance. And also, without that seat of rest, there's sickness, there's disease, all these other things that come when we don't find the seat of rest. And it is only found in Jesus when you choose calling instead of choosing comfort. And then there's the fulfillment of pursuing your birthright. without concern for comfort and security. So that means that if God tells you right now, you need to get on a plane, go to this place, you don't look at, oh, what is my, is that comfortable? No, you keep doing, and because you become faithful, then God is able to give you more. And that's why I'm saying, if God has just told you, one day you will be in government, He has not told you what position. Can you go and volunteer? And so the more you keep volunteering, the more He directs you, the more He sees your faithfulness. So don't just sit there when you have been given or when you know. You know, God gives you that inner knowing on the direction that you're supposed to go. Start stepping. Take a step of faith. And then now from there, God is going to open the door for you to keep moving. And then the other one is you are able to synchronize God, your time with God's time, and then you synchronize your time with the intended time for the blessing. And this is where we are going to stop, because we see that the blessing for the Israelites was when they were supposed to receive, not just a small thing. They were supposed to actually be able to receive the inheritance. And so if you don't break this enemy, then that means we're going to continue just a bit of this next time, where you synchronize the time, the season that God is supposed to bless you with the time that you are actually able to receive the blessing. So there is no that time delay and time being devoured. God bless you, and we'll continue with this next time.